Welcome to Trivial Debates.
Okay, welcome to this week's edition of Trivial Debates, coming to you live from Burlington.
Coming to you live from Burlington's Rib Fest, the biggest Rib Fest in Canada.
Yes, it is.
Honeymoon Sweet is here tonight.
Which nobody knows who that is or cares.
Yeah. They're playing all sorts of cover songs like...
They're not, actually.
They're not?
No.
The other people were.
Honeymoon Sweet is actually their own band, and they'll actually play their own shit.
All I heard was cover crap when I was coming in.
Yeah, it was all covers.
Because you didn't look up Honeymoon Sweet, did you?
Because none of us really care.
They're a good Canadian band.
Each week, our panelists will be judged on their scores based on their arguments for fact, passion, and creativities. Our panelists this week will be...
Dave Mader. And Jeff Mader.
And Chris Seymour.
And we have a fact checker.
Oh, our fact checker?
Mader. Do you have your device for fact checking?
It's charging over there, but...
So what good are you?
not much
right now, but you know, halfway into the show, he'll be all, yeah. All over.
When the questions start, we'll go get it. The way the show works, there are 6 rounds plus a speed round for our top 2 panelists. The rounds are movies, television, music, sports, history, and a wild card. We won't be able to be passionate about their arguments, but preferably not mean to each other, at least as much as possible. Keep in mind, you can skip to a new debate by looking at the time...
Index.
Subscribe to our iTunes feed, follow us on Facebook, Twitter, Google+, and Instagram. Whether you're listening on iTunes or watching on YouTube version, all links and information can be found in the episode description or at our website, www.trivialdebates.com. Let the battle begin.
Ding, ding, ding.
Okay, we're going to start with movies today. The question is, what star should just give up and do porn where acting really isn't required?
This is the best question we've had on Trivial Debates.
It was criticized highly by Jody Simpson.
Was it?
Why?
It was.
He just didn't like any of Tim's questions. Yeah. Just gotta put it out
there.
But
that's because Jody is a Seymour hater.
Yeah, he's a hater. I was like, haters gonna hate Tim. He's like, I like Tim. He's the better looking Seymour. If I had to fuck a Seymour, I would fuck Tim.
Yeah, but Dave, you agreed with him on that.
Yeah. I'm not saying you're unfuckable, Chris, but, like, you know, it's just if I had to choose.
I wouldn't let either of you fuck me, so...
Well, exactly.
This is about celebrities.
Okay, who's going to go first?
Celebrities.
Yeah, let's go back to the question about what star should give up and just do porn where they don't really have to act.
Okay. All right, who's first?
We will start with Dave.
Okay, I picked Ashton Kutcher. He is at the top of some of the worst actor lists, period.
Killer's awesome movie.
Awesome.
Killers.
Okay.
Did you see that movie?
No.
Awesome.
No, it's not.
Okay. I saw that movie. I have it.
And you liked it?
It's actually pretty good.
And Ashton Kutcher is good in it? Do you feel his acting chops lived up for that film?
I spent more time looking at the girl that played beside him.
Right.
Yeah, because that was Cameron Diaz.
No, it wasn't.
That's someone who's
no, it wasn't. It
doesn't matter.
Someone like that.
Okay, well, what are some of Ashton Kutcher's movies?
Butterfly Effect. You want to talk about bad acting? Watch The Butterfly Effect. He is awful in it. He is not a good actor. He mainly kind of goes off his attitude and his...
Whatever
limited sense of charisma he has, he tries to monopolize on this very badly. He is a good-looking man, I suppose. You know, he married... what's his name? In the
Demi
finale?
Moore.
No, in the finale of...
Wait, what's his name?
Yeah,
he married to Mila Kunis.
No, in...
Mila Kunis, but he married Demi Moore and Mila Kunis in real life.
2 and a Half Men. That's John Cryer? Mm-hmm. At the end of the show, don't they get married?
I don't know. I stopped watching that show, Dave.
Exactly.
Charlie Sheen left.
And then they replaced it with Ashton Kutcher, and it ruined the show.
But that's not TV, Dave. That's not movies. That's TV.
Okay, well, what's...
But he is still a movie star.
He's a movie star. A movie / TV star. As a movie star...
I know, but you can't argue that it was bad on TV.
If I just have to go off his movie credentials, he's got, what, Butterfly Effect and what else? Nothing.
Killers. He played awesome Steve Jobs in a movie.
He played a very bad version of Steve Jobs.
Still played Steve Jobs. He was cast in a good movie. Not a good movie, but like a movie that was supposed to be good.
This is very much
a lot of money.
This is very much in line with the music question, which we'll get to later, by just somebody who gets by on their looks. I think the same applies to movie stars just as much.
I don't think Ashton Kutcher's like, I'm not gay, but if I were, I wouldn't think Ashton Kutcher's a good-looking dude.
But he'd be good. I think he'd be good for a porn.
See, like, I almost went a male route, and I almost picked David Hasselhoff. Because to me, that is the epitome of a fucking porn star, is David Hasselhoff. But he never did.
Yeah, he did the burger porn.
Yeah.
Eating the cheeseburger.
Okay, I think Dave's just about done here.
Well, what else can you say? Like, he's a terrible actor, his movies are awful, he's got a little bit of looks, but he typically gets by in Hollywood by marrying A-list celebrities like Demi Moore and his former TV co-star Mila Kunis. But otherwise, is he relevant at all? No. But he gets paid a lot of money. And he should just give up, do porn, he'd be much better at it.
Yeah. That makes him pretty relevant if people pay him money.
Yeah, people pay him a lot of money.
Anyways. And they don't pay him to do porn.
I would like to get paid to do porn. But let's move on to Jeff. Okay.
All right, I picked a female. I picked Miley Cyrus. Now, if there's...
She's in movies?
She has been. Yep, she's Hannah Montana.
She's more of a voice actress.
No, but she's been in some movies. She was in a movie with Demi Moore called Laughing Out Loud in 2012. LOL. She was in a movie called The Last Song in 2010. She was in Big Fish in 2003 when she was a kid. So she's been in movies.
Big Fish was a freaking awesome movie. I love that movie.
Okay, who cares?
Who is she in that? But I don't know who she was in that.
I don't... She's a kid. I don't know. She was in it. Who cares? It doesn't matter. She's Miley Cyrus. We all know who she is. And it's because she refuses to let anyone know, to let everyone know that she wants to get nude. She wants to stick her tongue out. You know,
her outfits at the VMAs were
not
even sexy. Like they were like just
were they?
Like, it's almost like she already wants to do porn anyway.
No, like that's why I picked her, because she's basically already doing porn. She posed for Paper Magazine, the same magazine that Kim Kardashian showed her big butt on. She went full nude with like a pig and like cake and smeared it all over her body in mud. This is fucking, she's like a pebble's throw away from fucking porn already.
Do you have a picture of the pig and the cake?
Yeah. That'd be awesome. I can do you have a picture of the pig and the cake? Did you ask for the girl?
Where's the pig and the cake?
Yes, Chris doesn't care about Miley Cyrus.
Also, Miley Cyrus is confirmed to be bisexual, so she can do lesbian and dudes.
So, there's actually a website you can go on that's actually got a list of the top 50 celebrities that are bisexual.
Oh yeah, she's one of them. Yeah.
She's there.
Is Ashton Kutcher bisexual? I don't even know.
Not sure if he made the list.
Have you read it? He might as well be. He wants to fuck Justin Timberlake.
Oh, that is a good picture.
Looking at the pig or the cake?
The pig and the cake picture. Well, I saw the pig picture. I don't know about the cake. That's fantastic. That's fantastic.
Can you show everybody else?
I don't want to see it.
She's not even new to these.
She is repulsive. I'll give you that.
But she's already not. I don't care.
So why would you want to see someone repulsive be doing?
I don't even
anyways.
Think she's repulsive. I just think she has the. She's like doesn't want to be clean cut.
She wants
to be down and dirty in the trenches. You know.
You're going for the trash factor.
Yeah, yes. That's exactly what she is, and that's porn. Like what? What? Like I don't see Ashton Kutcher doing porn.
He can do a high. He can do
Miley
a high.
Cyrus, 5 years. Fucking
he
money in the bank.
He wouldn't even be good at porn because he's a terrible actor.
He would de-elevate the porn.
He would, like, there are better actors, male porn stars, who are better actors, right?
I don't know. I mean, like, Ashton Kutcher,
I don't know. Like, Peter North is pretty good.
Obviously, many people thought Ashton Kutcher could do
Chris is
many
the
ones.
One watching the guys.
Like, I saw that the porn parody of Anchorman. Like the Ron Burgundy porn parody.
Oh, yeah.
Right? He was better than Ashton Kutcher would have been in the same role.
I'm not sure.
So, no, trust me. Take my word for it.
Have you seen the movie?
I have not seen the parody. I've seen Anchorman. I have not seen the parody. All
right. Okay, let's move on to Chris here. Let's see what his answer is.
Okay. My answer, I don't have a lot of explaining to do.
Well, that helps you.
All right,
so,
round over.
So I don't have a huge debate here, but my choice is Kristen Stewart.
Oh, really? Okay.
Yeah, the reason is we all know who Kristen Stewart is, right?
What, we want an emo porn? What's going on?
No, here's the thing. Here's why she would be better in porn. See, you know that Daryl shirt that we have? Like the expressions of Daryl? or Expressions of Vader, that shirt, there could be a shirt, Expressions of Kristen Stewart, and it would be the exact same shirt. She never changes her expression. She always looks the same. In porn, at least you don't have to show her face.
You kind of do.
You don't.
When the dick goes in the mouth, you have to see the face. Well,
but that's not that.
They only show the girl, not the
that
guy.
That is only about 20% of the scene, where 80% of it could be anal or something else.
They still have to see the face.
They wouldn't have to show the face that much. Because I'm sure she would have the same expression.
Then you can cast anyone. If you don't want to show the person, cast anybody in that fucking logic.
How many porns have you watched? They don't show the face a lot.
They do.
And they always show the girl.
Yeah. Yeah, it always ends with a facial.
Well, that's fine. That's fine. She could have like splurge all over her face, and that's great.
Because then you're covering it up.
It would still be the same expression, just covered up with splurge. And she's horrible at interviews too. It's like she has no personality whatsoever.
Well, porn stars don't have to do interviews.
Again, she gets cast.
They don't exactly. That's why she would be great at it. You're helping me, Dave. Thank you.
She gets cast an awful lot.
Thank you, Dave, for helping me. What?
She gets cast an awful lot of movies for some of that stuff.
Wasn't she just in this American Ultra?
Yeah, American Ultra.
I don't know.
She had previously worked with Jesse Eisenberg on.
And now she's dating Jesse Eisenberg.
She dated him now.
Yeah.
Maybe they should do a porn together.
That, see, if you could miss Eisenberg, then you might have had...
No, he's a good actor. He's a better actor than Ashton Kutcher.
They're about the same.
So my choice is Kristen Stewart, and I think my point is made. No facial expression. She might as well do porn, because that's it.
Okay, originally I was thinking it was going to be down between Dave and Jeff, but I think Chris actually had a pretty good argument there with all the splurge thing over the face.
Well, you know what? You want to know who would look better with splurge on their face? Ashton Kutcher.
So now you're talking about gay porn.
Now you got to get him doing gay porn.
Gay porn is just as legitimate as any other kind of porn.
Okay.
Or bisexual porn.
Okay, let's go down to 10 seconds for each between Jeff and Chris.
Well, I have to go first?
Yeah.
Like, what more do I need to say? Miley Cyrus literally is already on the track toward porn. Kristen Stewart is making good movie after good movie. Miley Cyrus is like one bad song from being on her knees sucking some dick. Like, that is going to be happening soon. It's like, this is like a hypothetical question. Mine is like, no. It's coming.
It's over. Miley Cyrus is also an artist. She's a musician. She's not just a musical actress. Like, my choice, Kristen Stewart, is only an actress. That's the only thing she has to her name. She's not a singer.
How do you know?
She's not.
Have you ever heard her?
What does that matter?
And it would probably
be
horrible.
If she's a singer or not.
Yeah, the question only has to do with their movie abilities.
I know.
He's done.
But still,
you're done, Chris.
See what happened to Chris. He'll be done. He'll be his face during the whole thing.
Okay, no one can see. The, no. Okay,
people cannot see you
on a podcast. No one sees your face. He did a pouty face, from what I can tell.
That would be her face.
Wait, can you do the face again?
Okay.
What?
Jeff definitely wins this first round.
Ah, yes.
Man,
you ready to?
Well, Miley Cyrus is going to be doing porn. It's happening.
Like, if I could have picked Kim Kardashian, that would have been even better. But she's a
she's not even been in a
she's
movie.
She's more of a TV star.
She's never been in a movie yet.
She's not even a TV star.
She's on the
TV star.
She's a TV star by far. Not a movie star.
Not a good TV star.
But like, if you already have a fuck tape, like, doesn't that put you ahead of the curve?
Or are you ready for TV?
Yeah, she's already.
So. All right, let's move on.
Like, I thought of picking her, and I was like, she already is a porn star.
She's not in movies. That's why I couldn't have her.
Okay, Chris, I'm kind of feeling sorry for you on the next category, too.
Why?
Because the next category we're going to move on to is TV.
Right.
What kids show could be turned into an adult primetime TV show? Let's start with Jeff.
I picked Are You Afraid of the Dark? And the reason why I picked Are You Afraid of the Dark was because, for format reasons. The format of the show, they could rewrite it completely. And right now, like the way it was years ago, was it was all kids sitting around a campfire telling ghost stories, telling all sorts of different scary stories. They could reimagine this in
any way. It's a YTV Nickelodeon show. Like,
what's that? No, but you're saying if we can go to prime time. What's the difference between a show like this or any other show that tries to scare you? You know, if it's revamped and it's given a sexy look, Are You Afraid of the Dark could work. It's
called American Horror Story. It already exists.
Yeah, it's not the same show. I guess, but it's not the same show. That's different. That's a show that changes periods, changes different
things.
But
it's a scary story. It's just spread over a season.
Right. But my show would change every episode, just like Are You Afraid of the Dark did, and would have the same...
Oh, it's called Tales from the Crypt.
Yeah, they're all this fucking same show, Dave, but they're all good, popular TV shows that can work in prime time. That's why I picked it. It's a good kid show. People, both kids and adults, can get into it. It can work in a prime time slot if it's well done. And I'm not, you know, going to try and write, you know, every little tale or every for you right now, because that's impossible. But what I can do is set up the same premise in American primetime TV. And like they've said, it's already been successful with American Horror Story. It can be done the same way, just slightly different.
All right, let's move on to Chris.
Okay, my answer for this one is Truck Town. Not sure if any of you guys have seen this show. Have you seen Truck Town?
I've never heard of it until Tim told me. Like,
Truck Town?
I actually had to look it up yesterday.
Okay, to figure out what it was. You and his brother. Come on. Like, yes.
Truck Town.
You would have watched kid shows growing up together. Truck Town?
No. Yeah. I don't know.
It's a town, it's filled with trucks.
I had to look it up and I watched an episode to see what it was.
This show only came out in 2014. It's a recent show.
Okay. It's a recent show?
Okay, well, that's fine. Go on.
Here's the premise of the kids' show.
Okay? I thought you were like bananas and pajamas or something.
No.
Truck Town.
No, Truck Town. There's all these trucks, okay? They're little trucks. They're like dump trucks. They're like tow trucks. There's like a garbage truck.
So like Thomas the Tank Engine with trucks. It's,
yeah, like Thomas the Tank Engine with trucks. And there's a crane who's also their friend. There's a crane. And the crane, Truck Town, there's no humans in this show at all. The trucks rule the world, right?
It's, so it's cars?
It's, yeah, it's like, it's very much like movie cars.
So far, we have Thomas the Tank Engine and cars.
But it's with trucks.
Why did you know it's with trucks?
And Truck Town. Truck. No. And these guys, all these little trucks are friends, okay? And they talk to each other. They talk. They do missions. They figure things out. And then there's the bad guy. There's the bad guy. His name is Big Rig. And he's...
Hey, you know there was a video game
and
named
Big Rig? And he's a Decepticon, right?
No, he's not a Decepticon, but...
This is getting way too close to Transformers.
Anytime the trucks are like, they come up to Big Rig, he's like, will you let me pass? And he's like, no, you can't pass.
Now, that's like...
This is a show for like 2-year-olds, okay? It's not a show...
Yeah, how's it going to work in prime time?
Kid show.
But Chris, how does this work for primetime adults?
Because you think...
Because... Now, the primetime adult version... would be way more up to date. It would be all it would be a world full of trucks and no humans. And all the small trucks would be against all the big rigs. The big rigs would be trying to take over the world, but the little trucks...
So Transformers!
The little trucks would eventually figure out ways to smart out the big rigs.
So Transformers!
But they would all talk to
like,
each other.
Is this a real like primetime drama? Is this a comedy?
No. It's going to be a drama.
Is it a war?
It's going to be a drama.
It's going to be a drama. It's going to be a drama.
Is
for
this,
sure.
Is this a drama? Is this a horror? Is this a comedy?
No, he already said it's a drama.
It's a drama. It's kind of like
Truck Town.
It's kind of like, it's kind of like a cop show.
But it'll be Truck World.
Like it's going to be kind of like a cop show. Imagine like Law and Order, but with trucks instead of people.
What kind of different show is that?
Order?
Yeah, it's good. Transformers.
This is after the judge.
No, you guys said Transformers. I never said that. They don't transform, okay? They're just trucks. They don't get turned into people.
They're just
trucks. And there's no cars in the show.
But what's the conflict of the show?
Big rigs versus small trucks.
Why?
Because the big rigs are trying to take over the world.
But how? That's my question. How? What are they doing? Okay. And once they do, then what?
I'm thinking Chris doesn't have a single check mark, so we have to cut him off.
Yeah, I'm not going to win this one.
And we're going to have to move on to Dave.
Okay, like when you first threw this question, Tim, I thought, kids show that's been adapted to primetime. First thing that came to mind to me was The Muppets, but it's already happened, right? It actually is becoming a kids show that's being adapted to ABC Primetime. Debuting September 23rd on ABC, but I couldn't have it. But when I thought back to my childhood, kids shows that really related to me, I thought about He-Man and the Masters of the Universe. And first of all, there's only been one live action adaptation ever attempted here, which was called The Masters of the Universe, a bad 80s version with Peter Langella as Skeletor. But it was the kind of the first realm into, like, how could you take that mythos of He-Man and Eternia and try to adapt it to real life. It was done poorly for the time, but a lot of adaptations in that period were also done poorly. I feel like this show really has the potential to become something that could become very adult, become something very serious and genre. With He-Man, you know, he's a half-human, half-Eternian. His mother crash lands on a spaceship launched by NASA that kind of goes off course and lands up on this other planet, ends up marrying the king. He becomes Prince Adam. Then he's introduced to the mystical world of Grayskull, right, and the sorceress. And you know, she would take him through this journey to learn the magic of, like, the sword. And when I held up my magic sword and said, "By the power of Grayskull," right? You could seriously, like, take something so campy as that and make it kind of, like, really cool and exciting in, like, the same vein as, like, Game of Thrones. I think it has lots of conflict. You know, you got lots of characters you can adapt, Man of Arms, and even Orko, who was kind of silly in the cartoon, but you could find a way to make that kind of interesting against Skeletor and his whole thing. You can even include the She-Ra mythos. Right.
It has. Maybe it would work with She-Ra.
It has all the components, the complete formula to be something that could be really well done in TV, and done in a more serious live action kind of way.
I don't know.
Brought to prime.
See that become more of a movie.
Sounds to me like Xena Warrior Princess, but like done worsely.
You know.
I'm thinking, Chris, you're definitely out on this category.
Truck Town, come on!
It's the trucks against the big rigs, guys, come on!
I did not expect the this category to get a show I've never freaking heard of.
What you should have picked, Gargoyles.
This is definitely going down to Jeff and Dave. Jeff, can you rebuttal his Masters of the Universe?
I started saying, like, I see that being more of a movie. I think they could do that as a movie better than a TV show, because I don't know if I want to watch a whole season of He-Man. I mean, but I didn't watch it as a kid. I didn't grow up loving it. I watched Are You Afraid of the Dark? And Are You Afraid of the Dark, when I was Eamon's age, scared me to shit. Like, scared me. Like, I couldn't get to sleep. You know, I'd watch that show. And that's what American Horror Story is like, but I don't find, like, I'm scared. I mean, I'm older now. But back, something about Are You Afraid of the Dark, the stories always got to me, and just the writing, the time and care they took into the writing.
And they taught you a lesson.
They taught you a lesson, and they can always change the narrative. Like, it could be a totally new story the next week, which is great, because it's not contingent upon, like, one line of storytelling. It can do anything it wants to.
All right, Dave?
Well, okay, in terms of, like, Jeff's pitch, to me, it's already been done. Yeah, there's a formula there, but Are You Afraid of the Dark has been done. It's Tales of the Crypt. It's American Horror Story.
It's successful.
It's successful, but it's already been done. It's nothing new. It's nothing interesting. Like, for me, it's someone around a campfire telling a scary story. Okay, maybe. But He-Man, I think, has something really original and interesting, more so. And it's an ongoing narrative. Yeah, it could be done into a movie. It could be a TV series and a movie, kind of like X-Files was, and it could kind of bounce and forth between the two media. I just think that Masters of the Universe has this potential to be something that could be done really seriously, reinvented, reimagined, kind of like in the same vein of a Battlestar Galactica, but you're taking a kid's property and making it actually fun.
See, like, I'm taking a show a Canadian show that no one in the States knows of, yet there are certain similarities to other Americans.
Gotta speak up here. My show's a Canadian
what?
Show.
I don't understand.
Chris, you picked Chucktown.
I don't understand why Chucktown. If He-Man is such a popular character and kids loved it growing up in the 80s, where has it been? Why hasn't it been? Why hasn't it been developed at all?
Well, that's a good question, and I think that's why it has to be made.
Yep.
I think it's proof that the fact that it hasn't been made is proof that it's probably not that good of a story.
No, it's a great story.
Then why hasn't it been done?
He made his lost with Voltron.
Chris, you're already out of this.
Which version of Voltron? The car one?
Lion Voltron. Only Lion Voltron.
Nice setup.
That's all. I don't know a lot about He-Man. I know there's Skeletor and He-Man and She-Ra. That's about the extent of what I know about He-Man.
Yeah, they're twin siblings, but born to a human and an Eternian. And this whole mythos around Eternia is really fascinating to me. It could be this whole mythos you could cross over with Earth as well, because we've established they live in the same universe. And the fact that He-Man's mother was a human, an Earthling, brings that to Earth and maybe connects the universe a bit more intricately. It could bring a lot more peril to real day scenario. Versus when you're watching, like, Are You Afraid of the Dark? This is a scary story. It's going to end up a certain way. But, like, there's more stakes.
I didn't even know you knew this much about He-Man.
You know what? Jeff actually was in the lead until Dave's rebuttal, and I think Dave wins this category.
Sweet.
I think your comparison to the X-Files and bringing it up like an X-Files show is what won it for you.
Hey, whatever it takes.
Alright, we're moving on to music. Ding, ding, ding. Which artist sucks, but made it big purely off their looks? Let's start with Chris.
Okay, I have a good answer for this one. My answer is New Kids on the Block. Don't know if you remember them, a boy band from the 80s and 90s.
Mm-hmm. I remember. They had Donnie Wahlberg.
Yes, Donnie Wahlberg. Good looking dude, isn't he?
A good actor.
Those other four douchebags.
And the, Jordan Knight.
Who?
Michael Knight.
Well, the rest of them.
Those other guys. This band was actually put together because of an audition. It was like, imagine today's American Idol. This band was put together due to like hundreds of people auditioning, and they chose the best looking dudes. These people did not write their own songs. New Kids on the Block did not write any of their own songs. They got famous because back in the late 80s, they attracted teenage girls to their concerts because of their good looks and their okay talent of the songs that were written for them.
They were the first boy band.
They were the first boy band. And they were
True. Jackson 5 was really the first boy band.
Jackson 5 had talent.
Jackson 5 wrote their songs.
They were still a boy band.
Jackson 5 was not put together because of their good looks.
As we know, the boy band model, like the Backstreet Boys and NSYNC kind of followed, this was kind of like the first version of that.
New Kids on the Block was first. They made a band. They toured together actually until 2007. They split up for a little while. They actually got together recently, and they're now touring again. And guess who is going to their concerts now? 40-year-old women.
But it's not based on their looks. I can't imagine.
40-year-old women are going to their concerts. I don't know how they look now. But the only fans that they have now are those same fans that they had that were teenage fans back in the day.
So they must like the music.
It's not. No. It's because they want to see the New Kids on the Block.
Donnie Wahlberg looks like a dried-up, pruned version of Mark Wahlberg.
Okay, but it's not like anyone's going to New Kids on the Block concerts now because they're like, it's not like young girls are going like, hey, or guys are going, hey, their music is so good, I gotta go see them in concert.
But they're not going because like, oh, Donnie Wahlberg and whoever else still looks good. They can't. They don't. So therefore,
these women are trying to relive their fantasies from the late 80s when they were teenagers. That's all they're doing.
Eh. Like, if when their looks faded, they wouldn't have a fan base.
You know what? Like, you know what? One Direction right now was put together by Simon Cowell. That band was put together by Simon Cowell. Only based on their looks, not their talent.
That's not true.
And
that's
you know
not true
what?
At all. They wouldn't. They just put four fucking good-looking dudes together and go, "Fine."
They do.
No, they don't. They fucking figure out can these guys sing, and then they go make music, and then they get
New Kids on the Block. Back in the day, it was a whole audition to create this boy band. It was an audition. It's not like. You know what? It's not like Nirvana, who became friends and started fucking playing in the garage, and they sucked. And, you know, they continued to suck. And then, you know, New Kids on the Block were just put together. And they're like, here's your songs. And now you're really good.
And they were good
and
right
you're,
away.
You're good. You're good because you look good. And you look good up on stage. And you can dance together. And there's no musical instruments on stage.
There's no talent.
It's just you five guys dancing. That's it.
They had sing, too. They could sing and they had good writing behind
They could sing because they fucking auditioned 100 people. To get five good-looking guys who could sing.
They auditioned good-looking people to sing. This is pretty much every star in America.
So that's a talent.
Yeah, you just kind of hurt yourself there, Chris.
Singing is not a talent. Not everyone can do it, therefore it's a talent.
Did you say singing's not a talent?
Singing is a talent.
Singing is a talent.
But being put together for the purpose
of you're good looking and you're going to be five guys that are going to be together and be famous. They are put together for that purpose.
Yeah.
Lots of people are.
End of my argument. No, it's not lots of people are.
Yes, lots of people are.
You think that...
What do you think the Mickey Mouse Club was? It was a factory of kids being taught how to sing and act and dance.
Back in those days. Okay, do you think Tom Petty and the Heartbreakers or Nirvana, you think those...
They're not the same brand of music.
You think they got together because they're good looking or because they got auditioned to be in this band?
No, they all figured out that they could play.
Exactly.
Right? So these guys figured out, well, they didn't, but their manager figured out they could all sing.
Yeah.
Therefore, they
just
can't.
Just like One Direction. Just
and
like
they had to audition tons of people to do that.
Well, yeah. And then they found five good ones, and they put them in a band, and they said, fucking go make music.
The
and
question
they
is...
And they didn't make music, though. They didn't even write any of their songs.
Like, if it was five ugly guys who had the same singing talent, it wouldn't have done as well.
It would not have worked at all.
Sure.
If it was five ugly guys.
I don't know about that.
It wouldn't have been as big, but... What's your favorite New Kids on the Block song, Dave? Do you have a favorite?
I didn't grow up in the 80s, so I don't fucking
know. Nobody has a favorite.
I have an answer.
Like, tough.
What are their songs?
Is that a good song?
You guys are a bit older than me, so they were more of a thing.
I only say their best song is The Right Stuff, because Weird Al did a version of The White Stuff.
The Right Stuff.
Yes, yeah. And he did. And it was
Weird Al did The White Stuff.
That's
why I like that song.
They did a song recently, too, though.
Yeah, it was about Love and Oreo.
It was about Oreo cookies.
New Kids on the Block.
How he likes The White Stuff.
They did a song recently. I mean, maybe like
that's
four...
That's Oreo is. It's not racist.
Maybe like 4 years ago. And it was like... it was something like... It was like In the Club, or it was something like that. And
in the club was 50 Cent.
I know it wasn't 50 Cent song, but they were all in a club, and it was Donnie Wahlberg, and he was rapping. And I was like, this is fucking weird. You know, I was like, this is like, these guys are all like 45 years old.
You're actually helping Chris right now.
Yeah, their music was not good.
I'm just saying, like, if they're still making music 5 years ago, obviously.
They're not making music.
They are making music.
They've never written a song. They got a freaking burger joint now. Okay? Have you ever watched a show? Yeah, Wahlburgers. You got a freaking burger joint now.
It's like the Sandburgers.
It's like...
Alright, let's move on to Dave.
I was just going to say with Chris, I think that the fact that they had a revival tour and people wanted to go...
Old ladies want to go!
Doesn't matter! If they're still going after that many years when their looks have faded, I think it proves that they still have some talent and that they have something to offer beyond... their looks.
Listen, his favorite song is The White Stuff because Weird Al did a cover. You guys can't even name a freaking song, but you know the band.
I'm not as old as you, Chris. 2008, they reunited.
Yes, that's what I said.
I'm not saying they're great.
I said they broke up in 2000. Yeah, 2008, they reunited.
Okay.
After, by the way, when they reunited, it was after Donnie Wahlberg was on one of those friggin' MTV shows. Like, friggin', what's the one with, friggin' Ron Jeremy was in the same show?
Real World?
Not Real World.
MIT.
It was a stupid show. I don't
step
know.
By step. They did
step
that?
By step.
Yeah.
Ooh, baby.
I gotta hear the song. I mean, I don't remember.
Okay, Chris, you have to be cut off.
But is that a good song?
No. I'm saying, like, it wasn't an atrociously terrible song like Friday by Rebecca Black. You know, like.
And she's not even cute, so it's not.
You don't think she's good looking?
No, she's 14, dude.
Okay, Chris.
She's not 14.
Chris, we're gonna move on to Dave.
She can get by her looks, that's for sure. What did she get by on?
I don't see if you can come up with a song that actually is good by them.
What?
You haven't named a song, but it's good by them either.
I can name all their songs if you want me to.
Chris, you're not helping yourself.
None of them are good.
On to Dave.
No, their songs don't have to be good. They got by on their looks, not their songs.
You're done.
Yeah.
Hanging tough?
Chris, you're cut off.
Okay. I'm advocating tonight that the only singer who got by on her looks was Jessica Simpson. Jessica Simpson is a good-looking girl who was briefly involved with a boy band member, Nick...
From NSYNC, I know that.
You don't even remember. I don't even remember. It doesn't matter.
Nick
I think that's right.
Mick Lachey, by the
Lachey,
way.
Lachey, yeah.
See, check mark to me. I had to give him his
but
answer.
Like her music is not. Her music is very bad. She does
it's
not.
It's not that bad. I mean, it's bad music, but it's not like she can't sing.
She can kind of sing with autotune.
No,
everybody can sing with autotune.
She doesn't autotune. Not like a lot of these other people autotune.
And KOTB didn't do autotune. At least they were.
She's a hot looking girl.
Definitely uses her body.
Uses her body to the utmost. And when her looks faded, which they eventually did, not to like extreme levels, she's still a decent looking person. But she's just not. She has nothing. She has no. She has no appeal. She has nothing that draws you in. And to me, she was a flash in the pan based on her hotness during a specific amount of years. When that faded, there's not going to be a Jessica Simpson revival tour like there was with Backstreet or fucking.
See, whoever, Dave doesn't even know.
Whoever the fuck there wasn't. See,
here's the problem. 10
million 16-year-old boys going like when they grow up 20 years from now when they're 36.
Here's the problem.
I really want to see Jessica Simpson.
Here's the difference. Like Jessica Simpson could fill a venue like maybe the Warehouse in Toronto, 3,000 people. New Kids on the Block, based on their looks, can fill the friggin' Air Canada Centre.
It's not based on their looks.
It is. It was back in the day.
But it's on now.
It's on now.
The question isn't about now.
Yes, it is.
No, it's not.
It's about everything.
The question doesn't say it has to be in 2015.
I agree with you with the fact that the band was put together like every other boy band because they're good looking. Like male singers.
Good. So you agree with me?
No, they can sing. They can sing, and they still have something. All these years later, when they're ugly,
they have their friggin' followers who were 14 at the time. Yeah, that's what they have.
Yeah. Where are Jessica Simpson's followers?
Yeah, where are Jessica Simpson's?
She didn't never sold out the Air Canada Centre.
Yeah, she probably could have.
She probably could have back in her prime.
Okay. Never. Okay. She never would.
Probably not. Actually.
All right. Okay.
Let's stop this off, Chris. You're done. We have to move on to Jeff.
I picked Kesha. And the reason why I picked her was because very similar reasons to Jessica Simpson. She basically wears no clothes. She auto-tunes the shit out of her voice. Every song is auto-tuned. So, obviously, she's not that good of a singer. Although she does write, so Chris has that leg on. She does write songs, but they're not good songs. She helped write that, that Right Round song. That was how she got famous. Was she sang on that song with Flo Rida, right? And that's how she became famous. But then she made the TikTok, you know that song, TikTok, on the clock, till the sun
shines. Nobody listened to this shit.
No. Exactly, nobody listened to it because it's not very good. But thing is, it's...
Kesha can't sing out the ACC.
Kesha probably could sell it out, but she would only sell it out for the fact of her appeal. You know, her appeal is like I'm a partier, I'm freestyle, free living, I just wanna, you know, go have fun. That's her whole persona. That's what sells her. Not her music. Her music's kinda shitty. You know,
so she has personality.
She does, but she has a image is better. It's better
way. But Jessica Simpson basically was like, tuna is like, aren't they like it's the chicken of the sea, right? And then she was like,
that's like, you're talking about the TV show. That's not even about her music. Who cares how dumb she is?
And the big reason why Jessica Simpson stayed famous was because of Nick Lachey, not her.
Not only that, she was in the Dukes of Hazzard. She's an actress as well. She's not.
She was also barely an actress. She's an actress in the sense that like I want to cast a hot looking girl for this movie.
Yeah,
player of the month.
Played Daisy Duke.
She was the flavor of the month when they made the Dukes of Hazzard movie.
Okay, I think because of the whole movie stuff coming in, I have to go between Jeff and Chris, just because
he brought it up.
I want to hear what the hell else Chris has to say about Dukes
of
Hazzard.
This is my round.
No,
it is. It's his rounds. You know what isn't his round though? History.
New Kids on the Block was just made famous because they were a boy band that was put together. They were the very first boy band. They're the ones that started off good-looking people doing music because not because they're talented, just because they're good-looking and they can play on stage together. And their followers.
So you're saying they had no talent?
They could sing. Which was fine.
They had personality. My choice can't sing.
That's the whole thing.
But can write. So they're kind of like opposites.
No, but my choice could sing, but they were picked out of 100 people that they were auditioned for this.
You know how many people auditioned to become famous? Like lots.
A lot. My band got put together and was cast into the spotlight. Kesha at least made it on her own. She had to at least work hard to get up there to get friends with Flo Rida at least. To get that song done, she had to make connections in the music industry.
She got
a mine. Was just like my band is just like winning American Idol, and now you're fucking famous.
Well,
no, it isn't.
Right, Jeff.
No, it's not.
Jeff, it's your turn.
All right, Kid Shark. Like, all right, New Kids on the Block is a band like that basically started the 90s boy band.
80s.
No, it started the 90s boy band thing.
Hello.
There wasn't really.
Hey and Tough came out in 1988. I had the tape.
88, Chris. 88, everything from then on.
And you said they were the first.
So, did you buy that tape based on their looks?
Yeah, that's what I want to know. Yeah. Were you a big fan?
Why do you have the tape, Chris?
Were you like, in one hand you had
I bought that tape because it was popular at the time, and I thought if all the girls liked it, if I had that tape, the girls would like me.
There we go. All the girls like it. And it's five dudes singing.
It's because it's a
boy band. But they might just
that's why the girls like it.
You like the boy band, don't you, Chris?
Right.
I didn't like. I know all their music because I had that tape.
It's not why they like it, though. Like, it,
it's not why
girls,
I like it.
Obviously, girls go crazy for boy bands.
Oh, you were
ready. This is nothing new. The Beatles basically started this, not New Kids on the Block.
New Kids, the Beatles is more than just
the Beatles
boy band.
Started in a freaking
they were
garage.
A boy band.
They're
they
not put together.
Elvis started
together.
This. No, Elvis was...
Elvis was sex on a stick.
Elvis had talent.
Elvis was a beautiful man.
Elvis also would have been a good choice because Elvis didn't write any of his freaking songs either.
If I could fuck a man from history, it would be Elvis.
Chris, I would say Jeff wins because this question doesn't have to do with writing abilities. It has to do with talent.
Right. Mine throws auto-tune. Your guys are still making music.
Auto-tune is what won it for him.
Can't believe I lost that.
Every boy band ever.
I feel like that should have been my round, but
can't believe
you didn't even make the final.
I know, I was surprised, but whatever.
That's the game, sports.
Ding, ding, ding.
What sport has the biggest wimps?
That's me. Well, it's pretty obvious. It's kind of universally known that soccer has the biggest wimps.
No, really only really in North America.
Everywhere in the it's global. Soccer is a global sport, Eamon. Like,
and yeah, I know, but
what do you mean it's only in North America?
No, but what I meant is that
it's only called soccer in North America, right? If that's what you mean.
Football. And it's only really hated like a lot of countries in like Europe and over there and stuff like this.
I think like if you want to think about North Americans in general, we are a tougher breed, I think, than our other global compatriots. The Europeans in particular. But soccer is a game that's it's heralded around the world, the beautiful game, all this bullshit. But you see these guys who take the smallest little thing and they put these theatrics on to show how injured they are. They're not really. But they will sacrifice their pride, their dignity, Tim, just to maybe get a call so that like maybe there will be a goal scored in a game. You know, maybe, oh, so the game won't be 1-0, maybe it'll be 1-1. Who gives a fuck? It you know, this is what, they're willing to sacrifice all of their integrity for this bullshit. Soccer is the biggest wimp sport, period. That's why it's never really caught on in a big way here in the United States and Canada. And never will. You know, globally, I get it, like, if you're a bunch of poor people, you got a field and a ball. We can make a couple nets, I guess. Like, that's why it's big. But other than that, it has no fucking universal appeal. The theatrics, like, you watch, like, Italy versus Spain, you want to see a bunch of guys, like, fucking sell, like, with Oscar-level performances on them get injured. Not because they're really injured, but because they're fucking like, oh, the guy touched me, and this is my chance to, like, have my country win a World Cup or advance a round or whatever it is. It doesn't even fucking matter. No one fucking cares, and at least not here, where we fucking play the tough games. We play hockey. We play football. Even baseball, where you get a ball thrown at you, you get fucking beamed in the back, and you gotta fucking walk that at the first base. You don't show the pain.
Yeah, whatever.
Right?
Jeff, can you believe that Dave picked like the biggest sport in the world?
He also like, picked the one sport that
the whole time
is run.
And like,
all you do is run.
Run and kick.
Yeah. It's not about like the sport that has the best cardio. I could maybe buy that soccer has the best cardio. Doesn't fucking matter. It doesn't make you tough because you can deal with like 190 minutes of cardio.
The thing with soccer is in soccer, when you have the ball and someone goes for the ball and they hit the ball, that's okay. But if they don't hit the ball and they hit your foot, that's a foul.
That's like basketball.
Yeah, it's the same thing. And that's the thing with soccer is that all the players know that, so that they try to play it in their favor. They try to make the guy hit them. They try to make sure that the ball.
Yeah,
just
it's not that they're wimps. They're
they are wimps.
They're playing the game properly.
They're imposter pussies.
You know what? That's like saying a guy who bunts in baseball is a pussy because he's bunting.
That's not
like
no,
he's
no.
doing this.
That's
little
a, that's a strategic move.
It's a strategic move to pretend that you're hit as well.
No, that's just that has no balls.
Okay, all right. None of us would probably picked hockey, but there's been plenty of times where people have faked injuries or tried to fall down.
Not to the level of soccer. Not to the reputation of soccer. Not even close. And
I'm
when,
just saying,
and when somebody does that,
happens in every sport.
When somebody tries to do that in any of the sports, particularly in hockey, that person is labeled as a wimp, and that will follow them for the rest of their lives, the rest of their careers. Tim, I'm done.
All right, let's move on to Jeff.
The only player in soccer that really has a reputation is the guy that bites people, and that's Suarez. I don't even know what team he plays for right now, but that happened in the World Cup. He's bit people on the field many times.
That would go. And then he's just a crazy dude.
Right, but then would you call the guy that got bit a whip? You know what I mean? Like
no, but that's an extreme example. But
I'm just saying,
all times on the whole, soccer worldwide.
What about when Zinedine Zidane headbutted the guy in the World Cup? Was he being a whip?
Well,
you know, like
he oversold it.
Well, that's not being a wimp. Yeah. He fucking threw his head at the guy.
If you oversell an injury, you're a wimp.
He didn't oversell it. He
if
smoked
you get
the
punch,
guy in the chest and
if
knocked
if
him down.
If you get
punched
and it hurts a little, but you make it seem like it hurt like 10 times more than it did, you're kind of wimpy.
All right, let's move on to Jeff's sport.
I picked basketball. Because basketball is the one sport where you throw the ball, the guy hits your tip of your finger, and you call bloody foul. You know, like
that's because of the rules of the game. That's not because they're wimps.
No, that's because they're wimps.
No, it isn't. Because of the rules of the game. Because you know,
no, there's plenty of examples. I've never watched a sport more than basketball where people cry to the refs more than basketball.
It's called soccer.
It's nothing compared to basketball. Basketball, it is every friggin' play. Every play, they go and cry to the ref. No, that I didn't foul. Like, what are you talking about? No. You know that.
You know what they do in every other sport too.
Not like they do in basketball. It's
no,
every
yes they do.
Play. No, they don't even. I've watched a lot more sports than you. They do it in soccer a lot, but not to. I don't think to the same effect that they do in basketball because it's every play in basketball, pretty much. You know, like when you watch like an intense game, guy goes up for a basket. If he hits him here, fine, hard foul. But you'll see guys. Smack guys down to the ground, and the guy won't get up, or he'll fake an injury, or he'll go off, and he'll come back.
If he gets hit to the ground,
yeah,
what you get slid across that, and you're gonna get like burns on your leg and stuff.
No. They do this for safety reasons, Jeff. It's not producing wimpy
what
players. Anything.
A slap to the arm is safety reasons.
Yes.
I'm just saying,
Chris, you're not making a good argument.
Overall, I get it's a physical sport, and so is soccer. They're all physical sports, but there's something about watching players cry to refs that, to me, makes
soccer
more wimp than someone who
soccer,
gets hurt all the time.
It's not crying to the ref. It's putting on a performance for the ref. It is like it's
right,
that's
not being a wimp. That's being
that's a wimp.
No, it's not. Being a wimp is getting hit and not getting back up. Or, you know, like, just, you know, say, oh, I'm injured when I'm not injured. Vince Carter used to play for the Toronto Raptors. He faked injuries all the time so he wouldn't have to play for us. He says
that's your one player.
Said all tons of players do it in the NBA, though, all the time because they are prima donnas more than any other sport. They are.
No.
Soccer are bigger prima donnas.
No, they're not.
Particularly the Italians and the Spanish.
What's the matter with the Italians and the Spanish?
They are the biggest of all the countries. When it comes to soccer, Italians and the Spanish are the biggest prima donnas, biggest like...
Well, Jeff named Vince Carter. Do you have any specifics from soccer?
Like,
players?
People? Like, the whole country, the whole national team. Doesn't matter. I don't need a person. I have nations
of
people.
The guy that's goalie for Italy, Buffon, is not a wimp. He's freaking...
That's a goalie. It's not the same as
the hardest position on
the goalies are probably the toughest people.
No, so but there is tough people in soccer.
But that's one guy and like 15
wimps. All tough. It's a tough game.
15 wimps and one tough guy, the goalie, who doesn't get touched most of the time.
Okay, let's hear Chris's answer for this.
You were waiting for this, weren't you, Tim?
Yes, I was.
Okay, my answer, and I've got to stand up for this. I wish this were a video podcast, but I will explain what I'm doing.
Is that a criticism?
The video in my head.
I will explain the whole thing while I'm doing what I'm doing. My answer is Olympic speed walking.
He's got a point, kind of.
That's an event. It is an event. Have you not seen this?
That's an event. Okay.
It is a freaky sport.
I thought it was an Olympic event. Ed, the original question that I had was what produces the most pansies? Okay, that's what I had.
You could have changed it, though.
That's what I answered based on. And when you changed it to wimps, I just decided, fuck it, I'll keep my answer. But guess why I chose Olympic speedwalking? You guys ever seen this?
You can't bend the knees.
Okay. Really?
Yeah.
So you can bend the knees.
Look
at that. Look at that.
Your feet always have to be touching the ground.
Yeah. The one foot
always has to be
touching the ground. You have to have at least 1 foot on the ground.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Right. So they do like.
And if you bring a foot off the ground, like they'll give you a warning card.
Yes. These guys, honestly, how do they train for this? Do they stick a pickle up their ass and start walking? That's what they look like. They look like guys with pickles up their ass.
If anything, they are one of the toughest sports.
But do they actually have a pickle up their ass?
I don't know.
You know what? I'm thinking that would not be easy to walk with that.
Chris, like, this doesn't fly. They are one of the toughest sports to do.
Oh, really?
It is the most ridiculous fucking sport to watch. Okay? I will give you that. But it is not a wimpy sport.
I think it is a wimpy sport. Like, speed walking. Come on. It's not even running. It's not jumping. It's not trampoline. It's just walking.
There's a methodology to it.
You have to walk really fast.
Yeah,
that's your job. Your job is to walk really fast.
But how far?
Like miles.
Who cares? They have to walk miles. Yes, sure. I can walk miles. I can walk to work right now.
They are bound by a certain set of rules.
Anyways,
this is not a real answer.
This is not a real answer.
This is a real answer.
That's a real answer.
Tim is coughing up his breath. This is a real answer. This is a real sport, and it's ridiculous.
Dude, he makes a good argument. I'll give him that.
Olympic speed walking is the most wimpiest sport ever. Like, who grows up as a kid? Who's like a 5-year-old kid and says, I want to be a speed walker?
Doesn't matter. That's not the question. Although when I was in high school, there was a math teacher, Mr. Sostis or something like that. And he was really into speed walking. And he had a speed walking competition in the high school.
Really?
It's not wimpy. It's not what comes to mind when I think of that.
It's the equivalent of badminton.
If we were asking, like, what's the weirdest sport? Okay, maybe. Sure, yeah. I would throw it in my top three. Maybe my top two. But it's not a wimpy sport.
I think it is a wimpy sport. You're a walker. You're a speed walker.
Exactly. It's just.
You're not a runner.
You're saying curling's wimpy.
Curling is a sport. You got to sweep. That's
you got to sweep that rock. You got to throw that stone.
It's just a different game. That has a set of rules, and that's
curling is like just as wimpy as bowling. Like it's the same thing.
Okay.
Speed walking is ridiculous.
We need to end Chris's little rant there. Even though I would love to put him in the final, because I'd love to see what else he has to say. There's no way you're making the final. This is definitely between Jeff and Dave.
Okay. First of all, basketball. Whatever. They placate to the refs in basketball. But in soccer, it is over the fucking top. This is like Meryl Streep level acting to try to sell an injury that is not even close. Like, there have been plays where you don't even... They prove, without a shadow of a doubt, there was no contact, but because there's no instant replay, the refs have to just go by what they think happened, right? And so there's literally, like, slow motion, no contact. The guy goes, and he goes down, and he overtimes...
Have you seen that episode of The Simpsons?
A lot of the times. But, I'm talking about the times they don't. And they oversell that injury incredibly. To incredible levels. The fact that they'll be watching this in thousands of years and they'll be going, I can't believe they allowed this. I can't believe this was something that people played. And somehow they thought this was something to aspire to. It's ridiculous.
Back to Chris's argument. He is talking about the biggest sport in the world. And he's saying, "Oh, it's just gonna go away. No one cares."
It's ridiculous.
The biggest sport in the world.
The fact that everyone in the world can
most
play.
Fans,
it's
most
not that everybody can play, Dave. Most people
everybody
do.
Does. Most people are not tough. And that's probably why everyone in the world plays it.
All right, let's see what Jeff has to say.
As for soccer, okay. It is a tough sport. It's hard to play. You have to run for 90 minutes straight. You know, you get one break. That's it.
That's like running on a treadmill for 90 minutes.
No, it's not, because it's you have to protect a ball. You have other players to play with.
It's not like you can speed walk around the field.
It's hard. Yeah, you can't speed walk around, although a lot of them do.
No.
Yeah, but it's really not the point. The point is basketball is the one sport where your pinky gets hit and you can, you know, say, oh, fuck, this is bullshit. Or you can fake the guy hit you. Or you can complain, like, oh, I shot it.
It's not the only
guy missed you. It's the same shit in soccer. The guy misses your hand. And you go, oh, and the ref goes, oh, foul. It's the same bullshit.
No, it isn't.
Yes, it is.
No, it isn't.
Yes, it is.
No.
I'm telling you.
Right.
No, I'm telling you right now that basketball and soccer are very similar in the same amount of wimpiness. Basketball, just, there's way more complaining. Way more. Like, to the extent, like, 1,000 times more.
Just because there's only 5 guys on a basketball court.
No,
there's 10. There's so many. No, well, 5 on each side.
Yeah.
Right? There's so many more guys in a
soccer match.
So
there should be way more complaining. And there's not.
No, no. There's less complaining because the ball only comes near them, like, periodically.
No, in soccer, what you see a lot of the times is the guy shoots the ball and misses, or it goes somewhere and he goes, oh. That's what happens.
Per capita, soccer has more wimpy accident, like, events. Basketball, for the most part, runs pretty smoothly without any of that shit. Like,
without
considering
what?
You have 5 guys.
I watched a game
5 guys
last year, where no 2 years ago, where the Raptors were playing Indiana, and literally the guy we have now, Tyler Hansbrough, pulled Jonas Valanciunas to the ground, and then Valanciunas faked an injury. He wasn't even hurt. Like, it happens the same amount in basketball.
That's still a foul in basketball, though.
Yeah, of course. It's a fucking yellow card in soccer. It doesn't matter. It's the same shit. I'm just saying that basketball, they complain way more than anybody else.
It seems like that because there are less guys in the court, Tim. But
yeah, it sounds like they complain less because there's less guys.
No, the fact of the matter is that in basketball, you have 5 guys in a smaller space that have more of a chance to run into each other, right? Whereas in soccer, it's a much bigger field with, like, a much bigger team. But the fact is, on per capita, there are more bitchiness and more wimpiness in soccer than there is in basketball. In basketball, for the most part, you don't see as many calls. If soccer was played with the same fucking assholes as it is, you know, in, like, the World Cup, in such a small space as it is with basketball, you would see incredible levels of complaining and theatrics that you would not see with basketball, just because that they're that much closer, there's that much higher of an incident of something to happen.
But this one is really close, because you guys have both put up really good arguments, and you both made good points, but I'm going to have to go with Dave.
Yes!
Soccer! I had to fight 2 people in
that was really close. That was really close. All right, we're going to be moving on to history.
Ding, ding, ding.
Ding, ding, ding.
If you had the time travel phone booth of Bill and Ted in their excellent adventure, who would you bring back in time to help with your history report? Let's start with Jeff.
Okay, I picked 4 people.
You can't pick 4 people.
He didn't specify.
Why not? Bill and Ted brought 4 people back.
He brought more than 4. They brought more than 4 people back.
Yes, and he
chose
to bring back as many as them.
You can't
choose 4. That wasn't in a question.
He chose to bring back as many as they did.
Yeah. No, but that was...
Reread your question. Reread your question.
If you had the time-traveling phone booth of Bill and Ted and their excellent adventure, who would you bring back to help with your history report?
Who would you bring back? That could be multiple.
Cheating!
I picked Jesus, Muhammad, Charlie Chaplin, and JFK. I'm bringing them all back.
You guys can try to quickly redo your answers and come up with more answers.
I'm not gonna.
Okay, the reason why I bring all of these 4 back is I wanted someone from 2,000 years ago that represented religion and still was relevant today, Jesus. I wanted someone else that also was from many years ago, but was also a little bit more modern. So 600 AD, Muhammad. So we could kind of compare the difference and similarities between Christianity and Islam for my history report. Then I'm going to skip ahead, 1,400 years, so I can talk to Mr. Charlie Chaplin. Actually, it's 1,300 years, sorry. Mr. Charlie Chaplin.
Why is he in the mix?
Because he's one of the greatest entertainers of all time. He understood
politics. Oh, really?
He did slapstick.
No, he didn't.
Robert Downey Jr.
Yeah, that's who played him. He was brilliant. He was really smart. He understood the world around him. One of my favorite movies by him is called the Great Dictator, and in that he plays kind of like a Hitler type character, but he's for peace. Instead, it's kind of like an ironic movie, and that's why I picked him, just because he understood political satire, he understood movies, he understood entertainment, and I wanted someone to encapsulate all those things because I'm making a presentation for other people to see, kids, students, teachers. So I wanted someone that encapsulated that, and I wanted JFK because I wanted a president that... of the United States, because I'm guessing I'm in the United States. I'm Bill and Ted, probably in California. And who wouldn't want to see the guy who got his head blown off? I would. And he was also...
He doesn't have his head blown off in the presentation, right?
No.
He's not going to remember that either.
I'm not saying like his head's blown off for the kids to see. I'm saying like that's for that cool would be an that awesome you get to movie. See him before his head gets blown off. So, anyway, but no, I just think he was one of the best presidents, and also, like, did a lot for civil rights, did a lot, for trying to get out of war, trying, investigation, CIA, he would have had a lot of conversations on media, taking over the country and the overall message that's being sent out. So, those four all together kind of sum up a lot of just human history and American history. So, I picked those four.
All right, let's go to Chris.
Okay, well, Jeff cheated. So, he's out.
No, he brought back the same people that Bill and Ted brought back. Same
no, number he of brought people. Back only four. Bill and Ted brought back, like, eight.
No, they didn't. Who did they bring back?
Socrates, yeah. Joan of Arc,
Abraham Lincoln.
Abraham Lincoln.
They brought back Napoleon.
Napoleon, that's four. Where's
no, yeah. More, right? There's more. Genghis Khan.
Yeah. They never brought him back.
Sigmund Freud.
So six.
Six.
Yeah. Beethoven.
Beethoven, seven.
So
they can only fit so many in the phone booth.
But in the question, says Bill and Ted. And you guys are idiots for picking up. No, I'm not cheating. You guys are idiots.
Jeff actually does have a good point there. Chris? You can add your answer if you'd like right now.
Pick some other people.
No, I'm not going to add to my answer. I'm just going to stick with my answer. My answer is Mary.
Mother Mary?
Mother Mary, Jesus' mother.
Perfect, we can compare notes.
My reason for wanting Mary is because she is the only woman in the world.
Who's the mother of God.
Who
didn't have a guy fucker and
she had a baby. She was a virgin and she had a baby. I want to know from Mary. Like, I would love to bring her back and like, how was it with your husband in the house? Like, when you went and told him... When you went and told him, like, Joseph, I'm pregnant.
She was already pregnant when she met him, by the way.
And like, Joseph was like, is like, we never even fucked. Like,
why am I not getting some ass?
Like, how was it?
Yeah, what was it like with guy fucking?
He was furious at her.
Was Joseph okay with this?
No, he was furious.
No, he was furious. I want to know Joseph's reaction. I want to know how she handled that situation. How she felt being the mother of God. She saw, obviously, Jesus grow up, perform miracles. Like, Jesus was a great kid. He probably would have been the most...
He was like Amen level kid.
He wasn't...
Why are you comparing me to Jesus?
Well, you're a good kid.
I don't think he even Amen's Jesus level. I don't think so.
And he's not a carpenter.
Like Jesus. Like, so he might become a carpenter.
Well, Jesus was already carpentering at 11.
Like, Amen, if I give you a glass of water... Right now, can you turn it into wine?
No.
Neither could
see?
He's done.
No, he could.
He could. He could do that.
He
in a
did
book,
that.
He could. In a book.
He could. He yeah. could do that.
In the fable.
In a book. He could,
yeah. It's not a fable. And I.
What do you mean it's not a fable?
Listen, this debate is not about
I'm bringing Jesus back.
This debate is about is not about me proving to you guys that the Bible is true, because I can do that. But that is a longer discussion. That's a
story for another day.
It's a story for another day. It'll take literally like hours to convince you.
And let's hear more about Mary.
What?
Let's hear more about Mary.
Like, she... Wouldn't she be fantastic?
When are you bringing her back? This is my question.
Now!
Okay, but at what point in history are you...
Yeah, like, did she just give birth to Jesus?
Or did she just give birth to Jesus? Or is it when Jesus dies on the cross?
No, I want it to be like when Jesus dies on the cross. I want her to have seen his whole life I want to talk to Mary and say, like, wow, what's it like to have a son like that? Like,
question.
You know what? Justin Bieber's mom is proud. Imagine being Jesus' mom.
Okay. Well, you're comparing Justin Bieber to Jesus?
Right.
My question is, Chris.
High five. Come on.
So she gives birth to Jesus, right?
Yes.
And she's married to Joseph.
Yes. And I want to know. I want to know
how she does. She have sex with Joseph and does she have more kids?
No.
Why not?
What? No, it didn't happen.
Why not?
Mary was a virgin. No, she remained a virgin.
Even if she was a virgin when she gave birth to Jesus, you're telling me that Joseph never fucked her in all those years and she never had any more kids?
Well, I'm not really sure, Dave, on all those statistics.
I can find out. You are sure that the Bible is true.
I am sure.
Guys, there's like a huge gap between when Jesus is a kid and when he's an adult.
You're telling me a married couple never got down in all those years?
Okay, Dave, think about this.
Yeah. This is about...
You've got a girlfriend or a wife who you've never fucked. She comes home and says, I'm pregnant. It's the Son of God. How mad are you going to be?
Pretty pissed. Okay, so next...
I'm not going to buy her.
So bullshit. Excuse.
A year passes.
But it's actually a true story with Mary, so I want to hear her story. It's actually a true story. She didn't fuck anyone else and become... Like, God didn't come down to fuck her.
Why didn't Joseph fuck her?
Because that would be the son of Joseph.
That wouldn't be the son of God. No,
after Jesus is born.
Maybe he did. I don't know. Maybe they used a condom. I don't know.
You said that she was a virgin up until her
death. I'm not sure. I'm not really not sure, Jeff. I haven't
looked at Joseph have had sex with her when he was...
But if you brought her back, you could ask her.
If I brought her back, I could ask her that.
When she was pregnant with Jesus.
I'd be like, did you have sex with Joseph after Jesus was born? This will be one of my questions. And this will be a great history paper because we could expand on what the Bible already tells us.
That's true. But I think that would have to be more of a Catholic school if you were going to do it.
It wouldn't be a Catholic school because Catholics aren't even real Christians.
What? We are the original Christians.
They're not.
Catholics are the first.
They're not.
We founded Christianity.
Whatever.
We? I thought you're atheist.
Well, I am. I'm baptized. I'm baptized.
That doesn't mean you're Catholic.
I'm part of the tribe. So, therefore...
No, if you're part of the...
Fuck all you like offshoot denominations.
Catholics believe in the Trinity. They are, like...
Mother of God, Mary.
So you don't believe
in Mary? You would make a good Catholic.
No, I would not.
You don't believe in Mary?
I do believe in Mary.
So Hail Mary, full of grace, the mother is with thee. Blessed thou art
I don't believe in the Trinity.
Our Lady.
But this has nothing to do
you
with...
You don't believe in the Trinity?
No.
So you don't believe in the Holy Spirit?
You are, like, you're fucking... He's out there.
All right, let's move on to Dave.
I gotta say why. Because the Trinity is the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Yeah. Okay? And the Trinity... puts them all as one person. They believe they're
exactly.
all the same person.
And that's why you believe in it.
But God and Jesus are different people. They're not the same.
No, they are.
It's like Neapolitan ice cream.
Actually, they're different people and they're the same people at the same time.
They're different people.
It's Neapolitan ice cream.
It's
man.
All a bunch of
chocolate, strawberry, vanilla. Stuff, all it's all the ice cream tub.
Why would this ever just get religious?
Why would God put his son on earth and not still remain God? He wouldn't do that.
Because he does both at the same time, though.
Listen.
He's God.
Why would God put himself onto earth, then kill himself, so he can resurrect himself
exactly.
to
ridiculous.
Save humanity?
It's ridiculous.
That makes no sense.
That's why the Trinity is not true.
They had
That's
to.
Why it's not
true.
That had nothing to do with the Trinity, what I just said. That had everything to do with the story of Jesus. And
why and how he died.
How he died.
I think we're ready to move on to Dave's answer.
Okay, if you remember Bill and Ted's Excellent Adventure, right? They go and they collect a whole number of people from history, right?
Yeah.
But the most significant of those people is Abraham Lincoln. And that's who I would bring back. Now, since Jeff was allowed to bring back multiple people, and since my history...
Who's allowed? I just thought about the question.
Since history, the history report may or may not be in Canada, because since I'm a Canadian, I would also bring back Pierre-Elliott Trudeau. To speak, but the
about
reason
what,
huh?
About what?
About the history of a country and the founding of a nation.
Wouldn't you want John A. McDonald for that? Over
no, I wouldn't want John A. McDonald was a drunk.
Yeah, that's why it'd be fun.
That's why I wouldn't want Abraham Lincoln. If you remember that movie, Bill and Ted's Excellent Adventure.
Yeah.
They go through Genghis Khan,
like he's like, oh, I like baseball. Socrates is doing it bullshit. Joan of Arc is doing archery. It doesn't matter. It's getting the crowd excited. But what happens when Abraham Lincoln comes out? The fucking crowd stops. The crowd stopper is Abraham Lincoln. He's like 4 scores and 7 years ago, appealing to that sense of patriotism. That's why I can bring Pierre Le Trudeau along for the ride. He's like the sidekick to Abraham Lincoln.
Are you calling Canadian sidekicks to Americans?
Yes, and I'm right. You know,
you're just offending your own nation.
It doesn't matter. It's true. It happens.
It shouldn't be true, though.
What?
Abraham Lincoln didn't even know what the fuck Canada was because it didn't exist yet.
It was only founded after his death.
Yeah, that's right.
So that's why I need Trudeau. So therefore,
to explain what to him.
Yeah, he'd be like, "Hey, there was Canada that came a few years later. That the government has no business in the bedrooms of the nation and all this shit that Trudeau would bring, and he would bring a different perspective. We need both icons at this United Can-Am history." Presentation that I'm going to put on. I'm bringing Lincoln back. He's going to fucking floor the audience. And for the Canadians in the audience, and we're Trudeau back. He's like, I brought the patriation of the Constitution. I went against my own people. Lincoln would be like, I went against my own people too, motherfucker. I had the Civil fucking War.
Yeah, you know what?
You know what? I'm going to tell you that...
Is that what they're going to say? The Civil fucking
War? Well, I'm paraphrasing. But the point of the matter is... that I'm bringing the two most iconic heads of government, respectively, from the two nations. I'm bringing it more together. I'm not saying it's American or Canadian. I'm saying it's both. We're going to present to these English-speaking North Americans. Hey, fuck, we have Trudeau. We can even appeal to the French. He'll translate for Lincoln. And everyone will get behind this advocating for civil rights, a showstopper, a great... two great orators that are going to come forward and bring a sense of national pride. The entire crowd is going to go electric in their excitement for this, Tim. You know, they
have to write a paper. You're not, like, performing in front of, like, the
people. No, yes,
you are.
That's Bill what Ted it is. Performed. You are performing. This is what Bill and Ted did.
Performed.
They performed. They brought out historical figures. They thought they were actors. It doesn't matter. That the fact that when Abraham Lincoln came out, that got them the A+. In that presentation,
and because they were in America.
If I had to pick,
yeah. They didn't know who Socrates or fucking Genghis Khan was.
Yeah, they were in history class in the U.S. And I'm gonna bring out Pierre Le Trudeau as our equivalent of Abraham Lincoln to help bring that all together.
I don't think he'll get a big like cheer.
Yo, he's getting a cheer.
Okay,
especially today,
even though. Jeff was the only one who thought of coming up with more people because of the way the question was and how Bill and Ted brought back multiple people. I have to go with Dave. And I want to hear what else Chris has to say about Mary.
Don't bring this back up again. Don't bring this back up!
This offends Eamon's religious
sensibility. Let's start with Chris.
I would love to bring Mary back, and we had this whole argument about the Trinity. She could clear this up for us. I would ask her, is God and Jesus...
And if she said yes, what would you do?
Would you convert to Catholicism?
If she said no, I would not convert to Catholicism. If she said yes,
yeah, I don't even know what Catholicism is.
Why? Why would you not convert? Like, I don't understand.
The only reason I would convert is if Mary said Catholicism is the right religion, but she wouldn't say that.
She might.
How do you know?
How do you know?
I don't understand these hypothetical worlds we live in.
She would say, because Catholicism was invented like 400 years after Jesus died.
And Jehovah's Witnesses worked?
St. Peter.
Oh, that was like 1,800 years after Jesus died. But they were invented because they studied the Bible and they figured it out. It's not because they followed what their forefathers did from the 400s. It's because they read the Bible and they figured it out.
And that's Catholicism.
Okay, let's move on to Dave.
No. And?
Do you have any good points to make?
That was a very good point.
I'm a little bit dumber for having listened to it.
Dave, I want to tell you something, okay? There's something about the Trinity that Catholics...
But why is Mary going to make your school report so much better?
Listen.
Forget the Trinity. Why is Mary making your school report better?
Because she can clear this up for us. But in the Bible, it says... God, Jesus, and the Holy Spirit are one, yes. Right? That's why Catholicism, they base their whole religion on that.
Yes.
It also says, it also says in the Bible, when a man, a husband and a woman are married, they become one. Does that mean that they're one physical person? No, it doesn't. It just means they become one.
Because they're not the same. Yeah,
you just made the
point.
You just made the point.
God is a higher power.
I did not.
The Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit are not physically one thing, but they are all part of the God entity.
They're all part of the entity, but they're not the same.
Yes, they are.
They're not.
Stop arguing about this.
Jesus, let's move on to Dave's point.
What's my what point do I need to make?
You have your rebuttal.
Oh, well, Chris is fucking retarded. First of all,
I think I gotta win this.
Biblical history is not even real history.
It is real history. It's in the Bible.
Jesus, there is no historical record of Jesus anyway.
There is.
There isn't. The Bible does not count.
Dead Sea Scrolls, found back in the 1600s, was from Hebrews. It was written on the Dead Sea Scrolls. It was, it's the book of Hebrews.
Was it written by Mary?
No, it wasn't written by Mary. It was written by freaking Daniel or whoever was writing back then.
He doesn't even know.
I think it was Daniel back then.
No, Daniel was in the Old Testament.
Okay.
Yeah, Daniel.
If he's coming back to talk to, like, the Pope or, like, the church, yeah, he can bring back Mary. He's not coming back to do a... He's coming back to do a religion class. I went to Catholic school. Religion class was separate from history class.
It is.
Okay? And history class did not talk about Mary. So, therefore, he's bringing...
Okay, first of all, the only fantasy is Christianity. The rest of the religions are fine. Christianity is the one religion that is, like, totally fucking...
I agree.
What do you mean?
Gotta argue with...
God sent himself down to earth to be killed so he could save people.
So that people can realize their mistakes.
He did not send himself.
Did they have
nuclear weapons? Yes, they did.
How? We've had like countless amount of people in this world. There's nuclear weapons, there's disease. How has God like saved our lives? I do not
understand. That was like many years after.
I can explain it to you, Jeff.
If you want to know our salvation.
Yeah, all right, I think I have a winner for this round.
If you want to know, I can explain it to you.
Wait, Chris, I think we have a winner for this round. This round definitely goes to Dave.
What?
It was
my first history win.
Thank you.
I thought Chris was in it. Chris was fucking out of there.
Chris was way the fuck out there.
With the two leaders of the two countries of North America.
Mm-hmm.
That's pretty
sad. What about Mexico?
Fuck Mexicans.
Does Mexico even have a leader?
Yeah, probably.
There goes my accent.
They do. They have. They're called drug lords.
Yeah. The wild card question. If we were cut off from China, what country would we get all our stuff from? We do get everything from China.
China has a...
We get all of our stuff from China.
China is the biggest exporter in the world.
Yeah,
true.
We get all of our... You look at almost every shirt you buy, it says made in China on the back.
Yeah.
Every toy you buy for your kids says made in China on it.
Anytime there's slave labor anywhere in the world, that's where shit's coming from.
China.
Or Africa.
No, Africa.
Mainly. No, it's all China. So, but if we didn't have China...
They have...
Where would we get our slave labor from?
They have bigger problems.
Okay.
Let's start with Chris.
My answer is short and sweet. It's Mexico. Why? Because nothing has to come over here by cargo. Nothing has to come by sea. We can truck it all up here. They've got cheap labor down there. Also, Dylan can help them.
Dylan's not Mexican. Yeah, he's El Salvadorian. He's Salvadorian.
Well, he smells like Mexico, though.
He might smell like Mexico, but...
You gotta mention this amazing part, like Chris.
El Salvador.
Yeah.
I think...
He tastes like, you know, black powder.
You know, I think about it, though. Like, Mexico, closest country to us with cheap labor. It's not gonna be the United States, obviously. Their minimum wage is just the same as here. Sometimes more, depending on the state you're in. Mexico, we can get cheap labor. We can get stuff trucked up here. That's the way we gotta go. If like it's not gonna be India. Like stuff is gonna come by boat. So Mexico, we can set
What's
up.
What's wrong with India then?
India has the Indian Ocean.
Yeah. What's the difference between India and China?
Everything has to come by boat. You know what? It's gotta come over in containers. It's freaking gonna take a long time. My answer is.
What do you think we got all our shit now? In fucking containers from China.
Yeah, it comes across the Pacific Ocean. Another ocean, I'll give you that.
Don't worry about the ocean, Dave.
You're the one worried about the ocean.
You know what's in Mexico is the salvation.
Mexico is the salvation. Cheap labor down there.
Yeah, because nothing can go wrong.
Cheap labor and fucking Dylan will help. If there's anything
that would be
wrong,
awesome.
If there's anything that goes wrong, we call Dylan and he'll fix it.
Okay, that's Chris's argument. Let's move on to Dave.
My argument's short and sweet as well. In my opinion, it's the United States. Made in America is an appealing thing for especially Americans. In fact, the top three exporters currently in the world are China, then the European Union, then the United States. I discounted the European Union based on the fact that they're not really one country, they're a collection of countries. So if you take any of them individually, they do not meet the United States. Therefore, the United States is number two. So right now, if you were going to say, hey, China's out of the mix, then the U.S. would be the top exporter otherwise. That's it.
All right. Let's move on to Jeff here.
What's your pick?
I pick India.
Speaking of which,
I got just as many people as China. I got an up-and-coming economy. I've got stuff. I got rice. I got jewelry. I got gold. I got
you got butter. Silk, I think.
Yeah, I got silk. I got you know, all sorts of different spices. India.
None of which we want.
No, of course we do.
Do you want to eat Indian food every day?
If India, or we're talking fuck about that. Like just sheer labor.
We're talking about stuff, India not just food.
We're talking about sheer labor to build shit.
Yeah.
India is the only country in the world that even can try to match China in the next 10 years. Because of their population. They need a lot of industry, but once they get that, they'll be right there with China. China had to go through that for a long time through the Mao period in the 60s and 70s. It wasn't until the 80s that China even became like a figure on the economic like world stage. And now they're the biggest superpower. And India kind of needs to go through that same thing. There's too many stir sticks in the kettle with India. There's too many different you know, dialects and ideas, but once it kind of unifies, which it could, then the amount of people they have is just the sheer volume that they could export.
They got a lot of people, I admit, but you know what? The true
they don't have Dylan.
The ambition.
They're also highly
educated. The ambition of every Indian, everyone who lives in India, is to move to Canada, and Brampton is proof of that. You know,
now let me ask you.
Yeah, because there's a billion people.
Let me ask you.
I work with a lot of Indian guys.
If one of the things that they imported from Mexico was an ice rink, would Jody Simpson be there?
If they import an ice rink?
Yes.
From Mexico?
Yeah.
How can they even make an ice rink? I'm not even sure I'll answer that.
Anyway, just looking at, like, I think India is the one country that has kind of underachieved, you know, throughout the 20th century. Now the 21st century has come, and technology is catching up. Cars are catching up over there. They have, like, the ability, their infrastructure is much better than it was 50 years ago, 60 years ago.
Yeah, but could they import an ice rink over here?
I don't know about the ice rink.
Do you know who has ice rinks? USA.
Yes, but could China import an ice rink?
You know who else has ice rinks? Canada, outside.
India is also the third richest
country. But, do you think of this? Could Canada import our ice rinks to India? Does that matter?
This is all nonsense, Tim. The USA is the third biggest exporter in the world. You take China out of the mix. European Union, to me, is disqualified. They're not even in the argument. Therefore, I win.
India exports to the world, third richest country. India shipped $318 billion worth of goods around the globe in 2014.
Okay.
Well, but not
44.4% since 10.
Mexico is closest to Canada.
Obviously, Tim. India is not no slouch in the export.
We can truck it up here.
Tim.
These guys are all retarded.
You have a chooser?
Yeah, I'm thinking.
These guys are all retarded. I got to win this one. You gotta win one.
All right, top 10 Indian exports to the U.S. India's exports to the U.S. amounted at 2.4.
You know, I'm gonna give all three of you a 10-second rebuttal because you all have good answers.
The USA is a huge exporter of goods all over the world, including and they also produce a massive amount of goods for their own country. Made in America is a point of pride,
in particular in automobiles and other industries. They're not even arguing for the biggest competitor, Japan, which is takes them out. India is, by per capita, not even close to USA. And what the fuck are you arguing?
Okay, we're arguing, wait, first of all, where are we going to get our stuff?
Yeah.
Okay, what stuff?
Anything.
Okay,
everything.
America don't make shit anymore.
They do.
They
make
do
a
not.
Ton of shit.
They don't make anything. What do they make?
They make cars. They
yeah,
make,
that's it.
You
that's
guys
like,
are
that's
already
where it's cars and weapons. That's like
yeah,
what they
weapons.
Make. Weapons. Yeah. Do we need that?
In terms of
weapons, do you need a missile, Dave?
Everyone needs this. Everyone buys it. They must need it.
No, they don't buy
in
it. Sure,
they
buy food, water, rations. They buy
clothes.
Those that close. Where do you think those come from? America? Hell no. Because the labor is too expensive.
In sheer of sure dollar amounts,
okay.
USA is
we're looking for
far beyond these two.
They're less. All right, Chris, let's see what you have to say for your rebuttal.
My rebuttal is in Mexico. We can truck it up here. And if there's a problem, we can call Dylan.
Okay.
Chris, you're out. Jeff has a win on this one.
That ties it. 3-3.
Jeff
won. I lost that one.
Chris, Dylan does not win the argument. Okay, for the speed round, we're going between Dave Mader and Jeff Mader.
And Chris Seymour is apparently out.
Chris Seymour is definitely out with some of the stupid answers I've ever heard.
Fucking lost every
very
category.
Controversial one.
Not really that controversial.
You went 0-6.
0-6.
You did come close on a couple.
You're batting 0.
Jeff and I are both batting 500 right now.
I should actually be 6-6, I think, in my own mind. But
but Jeff and Dave both won 3 rounds each.
It's my mind. We'll see. I'd be winning 6-7.
So,
if you get to be a contestant and the judge, you'd always win.
So we're going to start with movies and say, what is the best musical movie of all time? Let's start with Dave.
Moulin Rouge. It is a great film. It is a great story. It's a story about the Bohemians of France who are living in the village of Montmartre. It is a great adaptation of modern music.
Hey.
Using the music of Elton John. Fuck everybody, like Kurt Cobain, every pop song you basically put through like the 60s, 70s, 80s, and 90s is basically in this film. It helps tie together this amazing love song, but they're done in completely different ways. Moulin Rouge is a beautiful love story done to amazing pop culture music. And it is Baz Luhrmann's greatest achievement.
All right, let's hear from Jeff.
I just want to point out that Chris told him something.
Nothing? No, I didn't.
I saw you. No, I saw.
Eamon, it's not a bad thing because help from Chris isn't really help.
Oh, you guys just got on by
your brother. If we're going to talk about classic musicals, I can only go one way here. The Wizard of Oz. The Wizard of Oz is probably one of the best movies ever made. Period. And it's a musical. It's got musical numbers in there.
Is that what Chris told you?
No.
No, it's actually not.
He told me some other movie. But if I'm going to go with a movie for the best musical movie of all time, it's Wizard of Oz, bar none. That movie transfers you into this world, and it's because of the music, the songs. It's really, like, everything that is one of the first color movies ever made. But and when they open you to the color, it's like you're walking into a musical wonderland, basically. And you got, you know, the Lollipop Guild, and you got the Wonderful Wizard of Oz, and you got all, you know, all the songs with the Lion, the Tin Man, the Courage, and the, you know, I Need a Heart. All those songs, the Scarecrow. All those songs make that movie. Without those songs, the movie's kind of bland. It's kind of like a, who cares? Like, it gives it its life. And without the music in that movie, one of the defining movies of our time and our generation as far as humanity goes over the last 150, 200 years, if we're going to look at one movie with music in it, then gotta go Wizard of Oz.
Do you have anything to say about that, Dave?
Fuck yeah. the Wizard of Oz, I respect it. It has some great attributes to it, but Moulin Rouge is a superior musical by far. Ewan McGregor and Nicole Kidman are magical in this film.
Can you sing a song from them?
Sure.
They're all songs that aren't original. Yeah, we're off to see the wizard, the wonderful Wizard of Oz. Really, like, all those songs are synonymous with the movie.
His movie is boring. It is trivial. Yeah,
boring. It's one of the friggin' greatest movies ever made. Like, you can't Moulin Rouge is a good musical, but it's not one of the greatest movies ever made.
Musicals ever made.
But mine's
a Wizard of Oz is not one of the best movies ever made. Oh,
Tim,
absolutely.
You have to give me 10 seconds.
Now. Okay.
Absolutely it is.
I think Jeff's won this round.
Tim, you have to give me 10 seconds.
We have to give you 10 seconds?
Yes. Because if I was in this round, I don't have to explain why or anything, but my choice would have been Yankee Doodle Dandy.
Yeah, that's what he told me.
That actually is a good movie.
Just saying, I probably would have won that round if I was in it.
Actually, Chris might have with that Yankee Doodle Dandy what? As James Cagney's only musical.
James Cagney?
Yeah.
Yeah, it was James
only
Cagney.
Only musical he ever did.
I've never seen it, so
really
I
good song and dance.
Fantastic.
Wow.
Okay, TV. What TV show do you think you would fit into as a main character? Jeff.
Lost.
Do I need to go?
Yeah. Go ahead.
If there's any show I think I could try to do, it's being a real life situation, which is a plane crashing and me acting like the savior. I gotta run around, I gotta help people. I'm not a doctor, but I can run. I'm like Boone.
You got legs.
So you
die in the first season, no cares.
Yeah, exactly. But yeah, if I was to pick a show like where it's like I feel like I could fit in, like most shows, like I don't know how to be a cop, I don't know how to be a friggin' doctor, but I do know how to be a guy that crashed on a beach. So I think I would pick Lost just for that reason. And then there's the whole mystery factor, and I can get into that. This is just an exciting show and an exciting type of show. And if I'm gonna, supplant myself in somewhere, I'm gonna make it somewhere I can at least be a little comfortable as knowing something. As far as like, all I gotta know is I'm on a deserted island, the plane has crashed, there's other people, converse. And that's basically what that show was.
All right, Dave?
I would best fit into Big Brother. I feel like I could totally.
Big Brother Canada.
Well, I am a Canadian, but I could fit into the U.S. or the Canadian version.
Well, technically, you couldn't.
I am a, that is based upon somebody who is, like, as young as 18 or 19, as old as 40 years old. I totally fall within that category. I am a master manipulator, Tim. I could totally work the relationships. I would have a great social game. I would manage my reactions. I would totally control the outcomes of the different series. I would be the Derek. If you go back to Derek of Big Brother 16,
we're bringing this stuff.
I would totally be him.
I'd like to point out that Dave has the full facial expressions going while he's saying all of this.
That's right, because I grew up among the French, Tim, and the French taught me facial expressions.
The French.
I would. My game would be based upon. Being somebody who's sincere and not a threat, but yet totally approachable and likable. I would work within that realm.
It never happens in Big Brother unless you're a
boss. I would be the first, Jeff. I would be that first. I would be the guy who would change how people thought about Big Brother. I would. I'm totally comfortable being under scrutiny.
You would play a lot like Austin. That's what I
think. In this season?
No, yeah. I'd be better than Austin.
I think you would play like him.
No, I would be way
you
better.
You would have
than
the
Austin.
Same kind of like personality, I think, in similar.
Like
ways.
A brute?
Just kind of like a guy that's like, I'm pissed off in the diary room. And like, I just see you being awesome.
I would not totally. I would not do like, I am a Judas.
Yeah, I don't see that part of you, but like, you know what I mean. Like, you know kind of what I'm getting at.
I would, no.
Can
I would,
they were also
I would not be as easily manipulated by the guests. I would give great diary room.
That would be
room.
Great for me, brother.
I would give great diary room testimonials.
Okay, Jim, this is the right. Speed round. Like, give me my 10 seconds now to tell you what my answer would have been had I been here.
What the fuck rule is this coming, Chris?
All right, Chris, you have 5 seconds to give your answer.
I would have been on The Simpsons because I would have been Ralph Wiggum's best friend. That's
that,
it.
That is the most credible thing anybody has said.
I think if Chris was... I just want to give this round to Chris.
Well, he can't win.
I know he can't.
He said like 10 words.
I want to give it to Chris, but I'm giving it to Dave.
Sweet.
But for the Ralph Wiggum, I do want to give it to Chris because he would actually fit with Ralph Wiggum.
Yeah.
All right, next
one. Are you calling him stupid?
What?
Are you calling him stupid?
He said Ralph.
Yeah.
Yeah.
He's Ralph Wiggum's best friend.
If he was being cast as Ralph Wiggum, I would cast him.
Yeah. That would make a lot of sense to be friends with Ralph.
Next. Music. What artist from now could have also made it in the 1920s?
They I'd say Michael Bublé. I feel like he has that like suave crooner edge to him, like singing those old timey songs. I feel like you transport it back that time. There's no difference. There's no adaptation that needs to take place with the audience or with the artist. I feel like they automatically connect once together. He's somebody who's a bit of a Renaissance man. I feel like his style would totally fit within that time period, and he could go up on any kind of stage in that time period and completely own the audience.
Jeff?
Good answer, Dave.
Oh, man, this is tough.
That actually was a good answer, Dave.
Thank you.
And you came up with it pretty fast.
I got a better answer, actually.
Yes, do you? Chris, I'm sure you do.
Give me about 5 seconds at the end.
Band, artist, whatever.
Basically, I can't pick anyone that's black. Because in 1920, that wouldn't have been very good.
Unless you're in a black, unless you're in a black neighborhood.
Yeah, exactly. I'm going to pick Katy Perry. And I can tell you why.
Why is that?
Katy Perry is like a diva. And at the time, 1920s, that's exactly what they wanted. Like, she's like the quintessential 1920s type looking girl, I think. Just right now, she's... you know, glamored out. But if you like the reason why I say that is you ever watch the show Boardwalk Empire?
No, never heard of it.
There's one of the later scenes. Steve Buscemi plays the main character. He's dating a character kind of looks like Katy Perry. Kind of has that same old timey kind of what Dave was going off singing style. And Katy Perry kind of has that same look to her. And I think she could fit in not with her music, but with her style, her image. Her ability to sing.
Especially back then when there wasn't much woman right activists.
That's true. There wasn't a ton of female stars, so I'm trying to kind of pick someone that I just think suits the time. Like, Michael Bublé is a Sinatra singer. That's from the 50s. He, you know, he would fit, but kind of 30 years too late. Katy Perry's, you know, 70, 80 years too late, but Katy Perry, I think, could fit. Her talent is there. And her singing is there, and she can, you know, bust out a popular song, and her just vocal ability is very good. So
I feel that my rebuttal. I feel that Katy Perry's songs have the potential to be adapted to that medium, to be done in that style. But Katy Perry, as she sings them today, totally irrelevant. Totally would be a total disconnect for the audience.
It's not irrelevant.
You
asked what artist could work today, and I said artist that can sing and can fit that era. Not that her music right now does, because whose music does? Unless you are
Michael Bublé,
who covers Frank Sinatra songs from the 50s and 60s, which is not the 1920s, which is the question you asked.
But it's close enough.
No, it's not. It's not close enough.
No, it is.
You know, two world wars happened.
And it was still, and they could transition from black and white to color.
There's not that much of a difference within those 30 years from the 20s to the 50s, and
that's ridiculous. That's like saying there's not a big transition from the 70s to now.
Well, there was more. There is more so in that example, but in that style, not so much.
Damn, you gotta give me five seconds.
All right, Chris, have your 5 seconds.
My 5 seconds. I don't have any time to explain Harry Connick Jr.
Does anyone even know who he is?
Yeah, I do. It's the same kind of bullshit answer Michael Bublé is. A guy who sings like Frank Sinatra, and then you go, oh, he's an old-timey singer.
The fact that Chris came my answer is my answer.
My answer is more...
I actually think I have to go with Jeff based on the argument and the time frame of pushing Bublé into the 50s and him actually putting
He had a singer from this era.
Like, but he actually... He actually explained her in that time.
Actually, Harry Connick Jr. would fit in perfectly back then.
Who's Harry Connick Jr.?
He's Michael Bublé 10 years earlier.
Yeah.
All right, sports.
I love how he agrees with
Jeff, you got sports first. Who was the hardest hitting boxer of all time?
Mike Tyson.
Ooh, you got something big.
If you're going to talk about somebody with a mean right hand, Mike Tyson. Mike Tyson was the man.
He murdered people.
He just drilled people. He also bit a guy's ear off, but that doesn't have nothing to do with his own fucking arm.
How do you know?
Because I watched it when I was a kid, your age. It happened live, and Mike Tyson was just... I didn't know a lot about him other than that he was on video games, and he was like... Because at the time...
He was in Punch-Out.
Yeah, it was pay-per-view, right? So you had to like... Your dad had to be watching it.
Good argument.
You know,
like,
you had to, video game. You know, you had to get lucky to see the fight, right? And I remember watching the Holyfield fight, and the Holyfield fight didn't end well, but for Tyson. But the fight was, you know, nonstop right hand. And a whole lead up to the fight, the whole promo package was Tyson was just clip package of him knocking people out. He hit, and everyone said he hit harder than anybody in boxing.
Dave?
It's tough. There's a few contenders in my mind, but I would have to settle on Evander Holyfield. For the fact to say that he had the hardest punch, he was the undisputed heavyweight champion of the world for a number of years. He was well known, well recognizable in the sport, and the fact that he went head to head with Mike Tyson and defeated him would only have to serve to give me the win here. Like, he was the greatest boxer of the 80s and 90s by far.
Tim, do I get my 5 seconds or what?
10. I thought it was always 10.
What the hell are you going to say compared to what they just said?
Muhammad Ali!
He did not hit hard.
He was a fast.
Yeah,
he was speed.
Okay, so I lose. Whatever.
George Foreman would have been a good pick.
I considered Foreman, but...
Foreman is what I would have thought.
Yeah. Foreman was up there for me, but in terms Evander Holyfield, superior, 20 years later...
Mike Tyson was the
way more athletic.
Pit bull. He was like an animal.
But winner of this one... I have to go with Jeff because you argued boxing skill, not hardest hitting.
So, how many points is that?
Three.
Jeff's up by...
Dave has to win the next two to tie it.
Yeah.
So, basically, if Duffy wins either of these...
Yeah.
He gets first pick, though. Listen.
Duffy.
Was he Duffy?
Somebody calls me.
Really?
Duffy.
Yep.
Can I go with that?
You can. You can stop.
History. Dave, who is the nicest dictator of all time?
The nicest dictator.
The smallest dictator.
Yeah.
Who is the nicest supervillain of all time, Dave? Well, I'm gonna say Darth Vader.
That's a pretty good question.
I've actually got a really
dictator
good
dictator of all time.
I think I know what I'm gonna pick, but fuck. I don't like it.
Can I say who I would have picked after? Because if none of you guys pick it, I'm gonna be super mad. Because this person is actually pretty good.
I already got my choice.
Yeah, but you're out, Chris.
Yeah,
you always have answers right away.
But I have an answer.
But this question has stumped Dave. You had lots of time to think. You knew the question.
This is tough, though. Like, this is like saying, like, who's the biggest jerk saint? That's kind of like the equivalent of this question. Which I actually probably wouldn't have heard.
Who's the nicest villain?
Who's the nicest dictator?
Have you seen that movie, The Dictator?
Yeah, I love that movie.
It was so funny.
I fucking love that movie.
What happened?
My favorite part is when he pulls the baby out and he goes, oh, it's a girl. Where's the garbage?
Did you see the thing when he did at the award show where he had an urn of Kim Jong-il's ashes and he spilt it all over Ryan Seacrest?
That guy is fucking ridiculous.
And he's like, now when people ask you what you were wearing, you would say, Kim Jong-il.
Dave, you got your phone on you? I'm trying to help you out. I'm trying to help you out here.
Chris? I'm going to say...
it's so hard because it's like trying to like say like the devil is a good dude.
Like, how do I quantify that like without even knowing what he's going to argue? Fidel Castro.
That's a good pick.
Who?
Yeah.
I'm going to argue Fidel because at the end of the day, his... intentions were not malevolent. they were based around the premise of,
yeah, you know who
I think, especially in his younger years, he was given this ideology around trying to overthrow a system of corruption and bureaucracy that had plagued his country, that just made the poor poorer, the rich richer. And him and his brother teamed with Che Guevara, who was a revolutionary from South America who was trying to bring socialism to the rest of the Latin world. And of course that was squashed in the other day by the CIA and the Americans. But I never got the impression that Castro was a malevolent dictator. Yes, a dictator. Yes, there were some human rights violations, and those should not be overlooked. However, I think the fact that Canada made that connection with Cuba from the 70s on, in spite of the fact of the Cuban Missile Crisis, the fact, you know, which would have affected the Canadians, us as Canadians, as much as the Americans. When a nuclear bomb goes off, it blows up people, regardless of border. It doesn't stop at the border. And the fact that we were able to make that connection, and then when Trudeau died, Castro was at that funeral, and that the connection and that ability to reach along the aisle despite propaganda was established. I feel like Castro, while he qualifies as a dictator, not as malevolent as some of the other examples that would come to mind.
All right, Jeff.
I'm gonna hate myself for saying this.
You say Hitler?
No, I'm gonna say someone much worse than Hitler.
Pol Pot.
Yeah.
Who's
killed way more people than Hitler.
Cambodia?
Yeah. Apparently, before Pol Pot became a dictator, he was a professor at a university, and his students loved him. He thought that all his students thought he was the most kind, gentle man, and was so filled with knowledge and so much worth that they went to his class and really enjoyed it. And then a few years later, he became the dictator, and I think it said he took out 7 million of 10 million Cambodians within a city within days.
How is that the nicest dictator? I think Dave's is nicer. He didn't kill anybody.
Probably, but at the same time, any dictator's a dick. And for
why do you think they have it in their name?
He's not really a dictator. He's a leader of a country.
Who commits mass genocide?
I wouldn't. Castro is?
I'll give you that.
Castro's not really a dictator. I don't think it's really the same answer. He's more of it's kind of like saying. It's hard because dictators are such a loose term because...
Well, Castro's the head of a communist country right
yeah.
now.
Does that make him a dictator?
Yes.
Yes, it does.
Okay, so Saddam Hussein, was he a dictator? That wasn't communist.
Yes.
Yes.
So what makes a dictator? Because it's communist?
No, one guy.
Someone who's not elected in, one guy running the show with no other...
One guy
so
running
president,
the show.
A president is no. in effect.
No,
because
they're elected.
No.
A dictator is not elected.
And they have checks and balances.
Okay, so Pol Pot was... totally different. He was a communist and just killed at mass. Fidel Castro didn't do that. Fidel Castro almost put the whole world in jeopardy with the Cuban Missile Crisis, but he didn't kill people at mass. He didn't have the same reasons to. He didn't. It's hard to compare dictators. It's like
I'm trying to figure out how you're helping yourself saying that.
I'm just trying to like
kill people in yours too.
I'm trying to figure out the question here because the question to me is ridiculous. Because to ask what dictator is good is like asking what Christian or like what divine God is the best. It's ridiculous. Is the worst. So, like, Muhammad sucks over Jesus more, you know, like, over Pol Pot, over Saddam Hussein, or Fidel Castro, over Hitler. Who's better? Who fucking knows? They're all evil, though, is my point.
But Dave actually argued which nice stuff Fidel Castro did.
But he's not a dictator. And I will argue that. No, he isn't.
By definition.
Right now, he's not. And his brother is. And
well, not right now. It's not about current. It's about
history.
I wouldn't say what's the worst thing Fidel Castro has done as a dictator? Name me one bad thing.
That would only serve to
incriminate
me.
Prove to me he's a dictator.
He's a dictator because he doesn't give his people freedoms as we know them.
Okay. So, any dictator that doesn't provide freedom to their citizens, one is better than the other? What I don't understand, like, this is a ridiculous question in my opinion. Because, like, to say, you can give him the point, I don't care.
Yeah, we're giving it to Dave.
Hitler over Stalin. Because
Jeff just doesn't like the question.
Like, no, just all the dictators, like, it's hard to say one's better than the other. One's a better, like, a good guy.
Are me and Chris going to say who we had?
Okay, let's hear who Chris and Eamon had.
I had Castro as well.
I had Queen Victoria II.
She's not a dictator.
She's not a dictator.
She isn't?
No, you definitely lose on that one. To be a dictator, you have to be in a communist country.
You don't have to be communist.
Or basically,
you just have to be the ruler of a country.
Yeah.
Where everyone says
you have to be in an actual dictatorship. That is the quality.
You have to have complete control of your country. Basically.
Yeah. Okay.
The president, guess what? Does in the United States pretty much doesn't go kill people en masse like dictators.
He can't declare war unilaterally.
Oh fuck yes he could.
What's wild?
Not officially.
But this,
he could.
He can't do anything with
United States. How did the Iraq war happen, Dave? Because there was no declaration of war.
That's another argument.
No, it's not. It's the same shit. They're dictators just as much as anyone else.
The U.S. finds legal loopholes.
That's right.
Okay, are we going?
All right, we definitely need the wild card question.
I have an amazing fact for you guys.
This is going to be pretty good, probably.
No, because I looked this up on the internet one day. What guy has had the most sex with different women in the whole world?
Well, champion.
Right? I thought it was going to be like Peter North, like some porn star.
It's Genghis Khan.
Genghis Khan.
No. You know what the answer is?
What?
Fidel Castro. Because this guy.
Well, that's why your answer wins.
This guy.
You should have known that.
This guy.
Thank you.
Fidel Castro did fuck a lot. That's true.
He did. He used to get
in the U.S. used to try to kill him through prostitutes.
He used to get like 3 different women every day. Every day. Like they would just go get them off the beach and they would go fuck Fidel. Every day, like for his entire life,
Fidel Castro used
three
to be
different.
A boxer.
He would like fuck 3 times every day.
Which is funny because you followed it up with a fucking boxing question, and he used to be a real big boxer
and a baseball player.
Yeah, baseball player too, and then he got all the bees.
That's it.
All right. The final question for the wild card is: if you didn't have a TV in your house, what would you point all your furniture at?
The window. Because I want to look outside. What do I want to look at a wall? That's fucking retarded. Like, that makes no sense. If I'm going to throw my furniture towards something, it's going to be the friggin' window. If I don't have a TV, what are we talking, like pre-1930 here? Is that what we're talking about?
What if you didn't have a TV?
Yeah, no, I'm pointing at the fucking window. It's done.
Dave? I pointed at the kitchen.
The kitchen upstairs.
Well, the kitchen's right here.
That's your house.
Well, that's my house, yeah.
Imagine like an open concept.
You would point for the kitchen? Okay, don't do that for you.
Just rearranging. Just rearranging your furniture now.
If I didn't have a Jeff, that's like the thing. Obviously, it makes more sense. To point at the TV.
He's actually doing it.
For the kitchen. For the kitchen. The window.
Actually, I kind of like this setup.
It's pretty sweet. I hear it from my window.
Yeah. See, Jeff is now looking at the window.
That works. Toward the window.
That's actually a really good setup.
It comes down to a matter of interest, Tim. What's more interesting to look at? What's out the window? In this case,
looking at food.
You're looking at a parking lot with some trees. But the case is, in a kitchen, you can always have a cooking show. Right?
But if not, you don't have a TV, so how do you have a cooking show?
Well, doesn't mean other people don't have TV.
It's a live action cooking show. It's a live theater kind of experience. Right? Hey, I'm going to make some macaroni right now. I don't have a TV. I can't point my furniture to the TV. I'll come gather around. I'm making mac and cheese. Hey, I'm making a stir fry. Hey, kids, gather around. Yeah. I'm making a cake.
Hey, I'm going to show these chicks. I always thought I would do really well on the Food Network. Why not have the Food Network come to me? People, like, I have friends over. Hey, guess what? I'm going to make you something delightful, and at the end of the day, you get to taste it.
Would you have Dylan come over? And
I'd have Dylan over. I'd make him a nice, like, Mexican meal.
You make him some
chimichangas. The only other option is my bedroom, which is kind of like a pornographic theater. I feel like what's better for my guests is
the kitchen,
a food show.
I would have put
if a live have, food show.
If you have guests over, though, you shouldn't have something pornographic going on in your bedroom.
I agree. I should have a food show better.
Before the guests over, and you're going to have furniture, which is what the question is, you're going to want to point it in a way that you can talk.
Why are you going to look out the window? What if there's nothing exciting to go outside? I can create the excitement right here.
That's not the question. The question is, which way would you point the furniture?
A fire.
And the answer is, not backwards, toward the kitchen. When you can just sit it in a way where you can both look out windows while talking to each other. This is like, we're literally talking about like 1920s, like how they would set up their house.
Yeah.
You know, there's no that. That's that don't exist.
Hey, okay. Everyone gather around, take a seat, take a load off. I'm making paella.
That's true.
Hey, if people are coming over, that's the way I want the furniture to sit. Because I don't have a TV to entertain people, therefore I have myself to entertain people.
What about a radio?
Fuck, it's outside. I'm more entertaining than that.
Okay, I think that answer, just give it to Jeff.
Well, you didn't tie. How are you feeling?
Wow. And Jeff wins this week of Trivial Debates.
Yeah!
Followed up by a close second from Dave and Chris.
You... Dude,
you should. I came in third. Yes.
He still came. He still came in even better than me.
What?
I still came in. Jeff.
There's not Chris on there.
By the way, the last round I would have honestly given it to Dave.
Okay.
Why?
Because I would rather watch the kitchen than outside.
Congratulations to Jeff for episode.
Thank you.
Jody, I'm coming for you, you fucker.
No, I'm going for the win total.
Yeah.
Say goodbye, everyone. Chris Seymour signing off.